Without me interrupting too much, I'd like to introduce Arthur Stepp. So he works at Bank of America Merrill Lynch and in Global Analytics on the derivatives side. Now, I've seen this presentation actually last week in Global Derivatives and Amsterdam. It's very, very interesting. So I hope everyone enjoys it as much as I did then. So let's just give Arthur a round of applause. I know we usually don't pause it at the end, but this was such a good talk, I thought we'd start.
Okay, good. Thank you for the introduction. So today I will be talking about gaining the alpha advantage from volatility strategies. So first, what I wanted to present is the kind of cyclical nature of volatility strategies, which is alpha in good times and beta in bad times. And to understand why this cyclical pattern occurs, I will introduce kind of factor model with risk aversion to explain the volatility risk premium. So then I will consider an econometric model to infer probabilities of stressed and normal market regimes and apply it to generate alpha from volatility strategies. So first I wanted to show some empirical evidence for the performance of short volatility strategies, and for this reason, for this purpose, I use indices from Chicago Board Option Exchange, which are related to short volatility strategies. Although they are not delta hedged, but it's the longest time series for such strategies since 87 and since 86, and it includes a lot of bad things that happen along the way. So the first strategy is a call, which is a buy right index. So it's effectively it's a long S&P 500, and every quarter it sells 3 months up at the money call. And the second strategy is a put. It's just a short, naked short, 3 months at the money put of S&P 500. Like, interestingly, the both strategies have limited upside, but unlimited downside. And yet, over long time, they outperform the S&P 500 index with, put strategy outperform, with excess return of 2%. And the volatility is actually 30% lower. So that its realized Sharpe ratio is almost twice as higher as for S&P 500. And then we put in terms of absolute value, the $1 invested in put index would generate twice as much wealth as dollar in S&P 500. So then we need to understand why this actually occurs. And the reason is the volatility risk premium. So when we talk about volatilities, we understand two concepts. The first one is the implied volatility, which is Black-Scholes volatility at which options are traded and quoted in the market. The second one is the realized volatility, which relates to realized volatility of returns realized during delta hedging. And we can define the volatility risk premium as kind of spread between the implied and realized volatility. So in this figure I'm showing proxy of vol risk premium, which is VIX at month start, and the realized volatility of daily returns within this following month. So we see that volatility risk premium is positive with average value of 3.6%. However, it's subject to drawdowns, and it's very easy to identify when these drawdowns occurred. The largest one occurred during 87 crash, then during global financial crisis, and during US sovereign downgrade. So in general, those that I showed the outperformance of short volatility strategies relates to volatility risk premium. which on average is positive, but it has this kind of cyclical patterns. So typically the way to monetize this volatility risk premium is shorting the straddle. So straddle is a combination of short at the money put and calls, and it has a symmetric payoff in terms of return, and it's very sensitive to its value is sensitive to implied volatility. And by delta hedging, the straddle P&L will be volatility risk premium times absolute value of straddle Vega. So, and the second also volatility skew premium. It turns out that this skew premium is even more pronounced than the volatility premium itself. So volatility skew, usually it measures how much at the money volatility or realized volatility changes when the index changes. And it's negative because of the leverage effect. It means that whenever index goes down, realized volatility, both implied and realized, will increase. And usually we can, there are two ways. So implied skew we imply as kind of as difference between at the money, out of the money vol for calls and out of the money vol for puts. And realized skew we can measure by volatility beta. The concepts I introduced later. But now here I am showing like skew premium, which is implied skew minus realized skew. And this, because it's by definition is negative, so premium is kind of negative. But still, it's very significant. And it's actually so significant that even one standard deviation away from the average still results in negative skew premium. And the way to realize the skew premium is by selling risk reversal. So short risk reversal is a strategy involving selling out of the money put and buying out of the money call. And this strategy, because of this kind of symmetry, is very like the way it's priced or valued is sensitive to implied skewness and spot volatility correlation. And by delta hedging risk reversal, we can realize the skew risk premium, which is multiplied by risk reversal of one. One is sensitivity of delta to vol. So the main point here is that the volatility and skew premium do exist, and they are realized by selling options. And net of realized volatility as cost for delta hedging. The question is, can the volatility, can the risk premium be kind of source of alpha, or is just beta? And for that, just to kind of understand, we need to look deep into nature, and then we will understand everything better, as Einstein said. So for this purpose, I will present a new factor model with risk aversion to explain the volatility risk premium. So what is risk aversion? So imagine we have one investment is distribution of outcome. One kind of it can have both negative and both positive and both negative returns. And say the expected value is positive. And if investor has a choice between kind of investing in random outcomes, where there is probability that he can outperform, but also probability that he can underperform, risk averse investor will always choose the fixed payment, which is kind of just the expected value. So in other words, risk averse investors, they care more about the negative outcomes. And imagine like investor or fund manager, his loan portfolio, like loan stocks, and he wants to buy out of the money puts. Because for him, he's more kind of, when he's risk averse, he's going to kind of pay more to protect against the negative outcomes. And the way when kind of we can imagine that whenever he values this kind of put payoff, he will always value that negative side of returns. So we can think that when we kind of want to value some derivatives with risk aversion, that we have kind of statistical distribution, and when we want to value some payoffs, we always apply this weight, which increases the value of kind of protective investments like put options, and decreases the value of upside investments like call options. And also, so what happens if statistical returns are have fat tails? We can show that whenever we have risk aversion and we apply a kind of valuation, that our implied measure, so we can always, we have this kind of statistical distribution, we apply risk aversion, we can value securities, and then we can return back. What is this kind of implied distribution means in terms of properties of distribution? It turns out that, for example, here I use a statistical distribution of S&P 500 daily returns, which have very high kurtosis of 11, and they have very small skew. What happens if I apply risk aversion, my implied skewness becomes minus one. Even though the statistical skewness is zero, my implied skewness increases. So what does it mean? So it means that there are two sources why the volatility risk premium arises. The first one is that statistical distributions are fat-tailed, and the second one that investors are risk-averse. Risk-averse means that they care. Even though the statistical distribution have equal probability of large negative returns and large positive returns, risk-averse investors care more about the negative returns. So therefore, when we say in terms of implied volatilities, so statistical skew is symmetric. Out of the money calls have the same value as out of the money puts. Whereas with risk aversion, actually we observe the skew. And the skew leads to first at the money volatility is higher, and the second the skew is higher. So this kind of is a theoretical concept. So now we wanted to use that and explain returns. So what is kind of, what is, say I have a strategy, how I want create a factor model to explain it returns. So the most famous model is a capital asset pricing model. It says that expected return on any asset should be proportional to beta of this asset return to market factor times the expected market return. So with that, using that model with risk aversion, I can derive the following risk premium term. So it will be, again, expected return on any strategy will be proportional to X exposure to the market plus its exposure to risk premium. And risk premium comes from like two key things. The first one is the risk aversion parameter, and the second one is beta of asset volatility to market return. So this is very important concept in derivatives and why. So for example, say we sell out of the money puts, and when the index goes down, realized volatility of our position will increase because of exposure to gamma and vega. And to bear that increased mark-to-market volatility, which always occurs when the index goes down, we need to charge extra premium. This premium list that is effectively is affected by our beta of this position volatility to market return and times expected market volatility. And using this model, so we can backtest. We can backtest if actually this vol premium is significant. So it's again, I'm backtesting if the risk premium, if the risk aversion is significant, and if actually strategy return meaning like short volatility strategy return can be explained by its exposure to vol premium. And here I'm using again those CBOE indices, and so what I do is I'm trying to decompose to explain monthly return on these strategies by its exposure to market return and exposure to vol premium. And vol premium is again defined as VIX at the month beginning of the month minus realized volatility of daily returns within this month. So as I noted, those indices are not delta hedged, so we have some exposure to the market. But what is significant that we have a significant exposure to this volatility premium. And regression model is highly significant. But what does it tell us? That that indeed empirically we do observe risk aversion. Because under risk neutral theory, volatility premium should be zero. There are, like under risk neutral risk premium, there is no compensation to taken on the mark-to-market risk. So next slide, I just explain very briefly what happens here. So with delta hedging, we can eliminate exposure to market returns. And so our, if we have diversified portfolio of strategies, we effectively, our P&L is vol premium. Our exposure to volatility premium times realized volatility premium. And volatility, so alpha comes from volatility premium. That as already showed, for example, for volatility premium, that there is an alpha component and also kind of residual risk. The residual risk is always negative. So our kind of P&L on volatility, on P&L for portfolio, it becomes a kind of sum of alphas minus risks. And what happens is that in good times, the risks are not usually not correlated. So portfolios usually like short volatility or short credit portfolios, they make alpha. However, in bad times, all risk becomes correlated. So why? All volatility strategies and portfolios, they have this cyclical pattern that in good times they make alpha, whereas in bad times risk premium spike down and all these strategies, they produce high negative returns. So in this example, I'm comparing the S&P 500 with a short delta H straddle. So always these strategies, they are badly affected by drawdowns in the index, even though they are delta hedged. So next, so we kind of establish this. So the way to make alpha is actually try to reduce exposure at bad market regimes. And so for this purpose, we need to model these regimes. And so first thing, we can just do some empirical observation. And here, we can clearly see, if we look at time series, we can clearly see periods of when the index has a negative drift accompanied with high volatility. And in opposite, we have periods of positive drift accompanied with very small volatility. So the patterns are evident in empirical data. And our purpose is try to create a model to forecast these cycles. And what is interesting that if you look at at monthly returns, so here I have a cuckoo plot of monthly returns on the S&P 500 index. We clearly see the fat tails. Whereas if we normalize returns, monthly returns by realized volatility within, by realized volatility of returns within that month, then distribution becomes lightly tailed. And using statistical tests, we reject normality assumption for monthly returns, but we cannot reject assumption for volatility normalized returns. So what it tells us? It tells us that fat tails in physical statistical distributions, they can actually explain by changes in realized volatility. And the next thing is we can apply regime switching model to make statistical inference about normal and stressed regimes. So there are three components. The first one is we need to specify distributions of returns in normal and stress regimes. And then using a Kalman filter, we can infer these probabilities of stress regimes from observed data. And the advantage of this Kalman filter is that we can also, given new data, we can also make a statistical inference what is the probability of this regime. So for example, here I have two different models. One is like model calibrated on the whole history with reds. So this is, it gives me ensemble forecast. And another model is dynamic, it's using some window, estimation window, and for each next month is trying to forecast what is kind of given the recent history of returns, what is the probability of me actually being in stress regime. And they pretty much coincide. The model has predictive power.
The probability of your stress regime is transition probability from a not stress state to not stress state to stress state. You fit to state. That's what you do.
Yes. Yes. It's a. So given this, say I calibrated my parameters at the year beginning, right? And I have kind of, so all the idea of Kalman filter in this regime switching that we have an observed state variable, which is like binary variable for market regimes. So and given that kind of, so I always, when I calibrate my parameters, I infer ensemble probability. And then when I have new data, it's actually my ensemble, like my forecasted probability will change depending on this new regime and the initial state that I observed at the beginning of year. So during the year, actually given new returns, I actually can infer what is my kind of estimated probability right now of being in stress regime. And then the idea, once we have we estimate these regimes, we want to size positions. And the way to do it is to consider the log of investment value and apply Kelly betting rule. So we obtain the following sizings, that in normal regime, it should be, position size should be expected return divided by the variance of return. And the same for stress regime. And because expected returns is for short volatility indices is positive in normal regime and stress in negative in stress regime, we should be long risk premium in normal regime and short risk premium in stress regime. So it's kind of, it's simple. But the problem that we need to infer these probabilities. And here I apply, so I apply this methodology, inference of regimes for backtesting of delta H short straddle on the S&P 500 index. So this is, and I do apply some realistic transaction cost, which is 5 bit per spot and 1% for Vega. So the continuous is that every week I roll into new 1 month straddle. I delta hedge it during daily, and every week I roll into new straddle. And this continuous roll, it suffered badly during the financial crisis, and it wasn't able to recover since then. Whereas with optimal sizing, I use my inferred probabilities regimes, and I'm making decision whether I should continue to short or not. And this is all out of the sample. And we see that so in terms of sharp ratio, the continuous roll produces negative sharp ratios. Whereas with optimal position sizing, I'm able to avoid these drawdowns, and I'm getting reasonable sharp ratio of 0.74. And also interesting that I can do long and short. So again, I can be short in a risk premium. I can be short in straddles during normal regimes, and long straddles during stress regimes. And this strategy outperforms by 40% in terms of sharp ratio. Also, what is remarkable is that when I use Sartino ratio, I have even better performance, because Sartino ratio is counting only downs to compute variance. Sartino ratio counts only for downsides, for negative returns.
So I forgot the previous slide. What's the performance for? So I mean, it looks like most of the gains there are being made during the really volatile, like your short, because it doesn't make the same line.
Yes. So
what about the like more the not stressed years in say 2013 later on? Is that how we get a?
It's usually so. It's
maybe that one is better.
So effectively say 13. So 13, if you would like constantly roll, you would generate positive alpha. Like drift is positive here, right? So this strategy is kind of, it's invest. It doesn't invest all the time. It invests when the signal is good. So it's trying to kind of avoid these drawdowns, but participating in kind of like investing more during normal conditions. And for risk reversal, as I already noticed, that skew premium is more significant than the volatility premium itself. So here I have a strategy which is short in risk reversal. And so even say with continuous roll, I still strategy suffers during financial crisis, but it's able to generate some positive P&L. It has sharp ratio of 0.3. Whereas if I use kind of optimal sizing, I'm trying to avoid negative returns. So therefore, I don't trade during financial crisis. So I'm able to considerably increase sharp ratio by 5 times. And the same for Sartino ratio, or 6 times. So what is next? So there are the two sources to generate alpha. The one is to generate the signal, and the second one is delta hedging, delta hedge execution. And delta H execution is particularly important when positions are not hold to maturity because of the Vega risk. And Vega risk is significant, especially for short straddles. And the idea is to apply minimum variance delta, which is effectively the idea is that because in equity indices volatility is correlated to the underlying. And so we can by delta hedging we can also partially Vega hedge. Vega hedge that amount which is due from returns, which is due to changes in volatility which comes from returns. And what is interesting here that actually when we do this minimum variance delta and we can use different models like local volatility or stochastic volatility, it actually doesn't matter if all models are correlated to the same implied volatility. And what is kind of important for delta hedging that, as I showed, in presence of risk aversion, implied distribution will be significantly, can be significantly different for fat tail statistical distributions, because they will imply higher skewness. And usually risk neutral models, they calibrated to market prices, they produce wrong hedges when implied dynamics are different from realized. And in particular, in terms of P&L, they do produce a higher P&L volatility of delta hedge positions. And our modeling challenge is to have a model with is consistent with both the statistical and implied dynamics. And for this I present my work with Piotr Karadzinski, the beta stochastic volatility model. So first I wanted to kind of to illustrate that in volatility dynamics is log normal. It is important to have a stable model which will work across different market regimes. So what I do here, I'm using the daily values of the VIX to plot their frequencies. And frequencies are normalized. So we see frequency, statistical distribution of the VIX is far from normal. Whereas if I plot log of the VIX, I get the distribution which is very close to normal. It means that volatility is log normal. And I can do the same test for realized volatility of S&P returns. It's again, when I just plot the frequency of realized volatility, its distribution is far from normal. Whereas if I plot the distribution of log of realized volatility, its distribution is normal. And then so to explain this beta model is very simple. It's so for each sample we plot realized returns, and against them we plot change in the VIX. And we see that they are negatively correlated, meaning that negative return on the S&P 500 will imply positive change in the VIX. And we can do this type of regression model explaining changes in the VIX by changes in returns. And this model is statistically significant. It's explained almost 70%. Usually, dependent on the sample, it can explain even 80%. And if we look, so log normality assumption comes results that we need to weight kind of residuals of this regression model by volatility, by previous value of volatility. And we also observed that if I plot these epsilons time series, there is no significant outliers. And also, as I already mentioned, that effectively this volatility beta is a measure of covariance between changes in the VIX, implied volatility, and the returns. And this is a measure of skew. It's effectively it measures how much volatility is going to change if the underlying changes. So a bit of minus one means that for minus 1% negative return, the VIX will increase by 1%. So in next, I explain very quickly. So as I said, we need to account for Vega P&L. Vega P&L comes from changes in implied volatility at fixed strike. And usually in practice, we can always mark options using this type of skew parameterization. We can usually add some convexity and some tails, but they are not important. So we are going to mark Black-Scholes wall at fixed strike using the money, using the level and the skew and the slope. And the slope is related to log moneyness. So when we actually, when kind of, what happens when the underlying changes? When it happens that using this form, the change in volatility at fixed strike will be caused by changes in at the money volatility and changes in option moneyness. So, and change in the money volatility is a stochastic change. It's something that we try to predict using some econometric model. Whereas change in moneyness, so change in moneyness is deterministic and is proportional to the return. So what we are after is to first we want to measure the change in at the money volatility produced by price return. And for this purpose, I use this type of regression. So it's almost like a beta, but I use as predictor, I actually use a skew from previous day multiplied by return on this day to explain change in the money volatility. And because so skew is now negative, if return is negative, this term will be positive. So this beta, skew beta is positive. And if we look at time series of this quantity, we see that say if I use a sampling window 1 month, it's usually kind of it's spiking. But over long term, if I use longer window for estimation, it's usually range bound between value of 1 and 2. So what I'm trying to say, so I want to have an econometric model to predict the changes in volatility using my returns and skew. So it's again, it's all this analysis is all necessary to compute volatility P&L at fixed strike. So now what I'm saying that, say I estimated that regression model, so whenever I have a return, I expect the volatility to change by this estimated skew beta, which is between 1 and 2, times the skew, times the return. And the log moneyness, I know that it changes by negative of return. So when I compute P&L at vol P&L at fixed strike, my changes will be change in the money vol, which I use this regression, times the deterministic part, which is just Q times return. So my P&L volatility at fixed strike will be changed. For volatility at fixed strike will be proportional to adjusted Q beta minus 1 times Q times return. So it means effectively, I always kind of say if I am short out of the money put, right, and say underlying goes by minus 5%. So obviously at the money wall will increase by 5%, but because my moneyness is reduced, actually I have some positive impact from this skew. So when I compute my delta, I'm adjusting, I need to adjust my delta by this amount of this skew beta. So basically, applying the minimum variance hedge, I will be hedging at Black-Scholes volatility plus my estimated coefficient of skew beta multiplied by Black-Scholes Vega times the skew that I observed today. And there are different regimes. Like we can also, like it's trade in kind of the trader's language. We can differentiate the following regimes. So the sticky strike is just Black-Scholes delta. That is a vector which says that at the money volatility will always slide across the skew. But volatility at fixed strike will not change. So actually, if the market dynamics is sticky strike, I just hedge at Black-Scholes delta. Right? And at sticky local, I need to hedge myself by the full Vega amount. And empirically, the purpose is to estimate this empirically. And empirically, it turns out this adjustment is, we can estimate it, this adjustment empirically. By estimating this Q beta empirically. And now, again, I'm using backtesting, so I have some statistical estimator of Q beta, which I apply for delta hedging. And I'm comparing three different possibilities. So one is sticky strike. I'm just hedging on Black-Scholes delta. Sticky local wall, I'm using Black-Scholes delta, which I adjust by the full amount of Vega. And this empirical is I have some statistical estimation of skew beta, and I'm adjusting my delta consistently with empirical observation. So here I'm using the Eurostock straddles. So usually for Eurostock, volatility premium is kind of fairly priced. So post Sharpe ratio, post transaction cost is actually negative for sticky strike and sticky local wall regimes. Where if I use empirical hedge, I'm able to generate some small Sharpe ratio. But the full advantage comes when I use my regime switching model to generate signals. And in that case, I'm able to improve my Sharpe ratio when I use sticky strike or sticky local wall, but I get the best improvement when I use also empirically consistent delta hedging, along with signal generating. So finally, it's always good when I create a model, it's always good to find what is economical rational for this model. And talking of these market regimes, or kind of market cycles, there was a very interesting book by Minsky, Professor Minsky, written in 1996. So what he said that a fundamental characteristic of our economy is that the financial system swings between robustness and fragility. And these swings are an integral part of the process that generate business cycles. So what it means? So what it means that is effectively no amount of QE, no central bank can prevent economy from and markets from going through cycles. And the risk premium that we observe in short volatility strategies can be interpreted as a cost to protecting against business and market downturns. That effectively people pay some money that people are paying for protection, which is not realized during normal times, but it still is going to be realized during bad regimes. And volatility selling strategy needs to have an optimal position sizing with respect to these regimes. And Regime probabilities can be forecasted using the market data. And alpha comes from ability to avoid market downturns and also apply an empirically consistent hedging. And this approach can be applied for portfolio allocation and risk management. And also, like at Global Derivatives, I spoke about similar approach, but for credit and high yield strategies. So, that's it.
Has anyone got any questions?
I was saying, I mean, the last part is, you're describing the common practice in the industry, and considering the change of law as a change of the underlying. It just depends on the model you use, but it's a common practice.
Yes, but what I'm saying is that we actually. Okay, so let me move back. So the common practice here, depending on if say I use a local volatility model, right? My delta will be adjusted by the vega, by the full amount of vega times the skew. If I use sticky strike, I just hedge at Black-Scholes deltas, right? So these are model dependent. Actually, empirically, if I introduce the stickiness ratio, right? So hedging at sticky strike, I would always use this stickiness of 1. Hedging using local vol, I would always use stickiness of 2. And empirically, we see that it's somewhere in between. So actually, by trying to forecast this stickiness using the econometric model, I get better performance in terms of reducing volatility of my delta hedge position. So I'm not using like neither sticky strike nor sticky local assumption. I'm just using whatever model is inferring empirically.
It's basically what is called the backbone. And usually,
yes, I mean, exactly.
If you trade you need to have this kind of estimation.
Yes.
And there is you can actually do this kind of estimation with Saber. There's a paper that was written also.
Is anyone got a further question?
With the regime switching part, didn't quite follow exactly how you were calibrating. I think you said you had to choose the distribution of returns in a stress regime and a non-stress regime. So how did you like choose your distribution of those two things?
So this is statistical estimations. So you can use the Gaussian, maybe you can use GARCH, like it's something that I spent a lot of time in. Like it's a necessity. Like if you want to apply the strategy, you need to work it out. So statistically, it says okay. I assume say that returns are Gaussian. Then I apply a Kalman filtering and use maximum likelihood to estimate the parameters of these regimes. And what is also important is like important thing is to have forecasting ability. What I noticed that like you can't fit distributions reasonably well, but your forecasting ability depends. Like, okay, you can have different distributions and you can fit your ensemble distribution reasonably well using different assumptions for distributions. Whereas out of sample forecasted probability does depend on these regimes that you assume. There is some trade-off.
I guess if there are no further questions, I'd just like to give Arthur another comment.
Thank you.
And